right color of clothing or the right. Bit peculiar to us, always advocated to have. Aristotle in 340 BC tie a string around the right testis. If you can't tie it, just cut off the left testis. Chinese conception chart supported the way that you can manipulate actually the sex of your baby. The couple should have intercourse in a dry weather on a night with full moon, after a good harvest, and when there is a north wind. I don't know how they see that. A man should wear a boot to the bed and get drunk before having sex. Take an axe to the bed. A man should hang his pants on the right side of the bedpost. A woman should lie on her right side during intercourse and have a small boy stepping on her hand. Sleep on a small, with a small boy just before having a wedding. Or the bride should wear man clothes. So as we can see, there are hundreds of ways. And equally, 50-50 chance mean one recipe is going to work. Scrotal temperature. For a girl, man should take a hot bath. For a boy, you should keep it cool. Don't take sauna baths. Don't work in a hot furnace. Don't work for long hours. Room temperature should be okay. Caffeine, the one drug that actually helps you to conceive the boy, this obviously is a Starbucks propaganda. Men and women should have high caffeinated food and drink a long term. For a boy, it's vice versa. Intercourse. At the afternoon, you get a girl in 1 moon and quarter, odd days of the month. Ascetic douches before. We have so many recipes, if you look at the net, and everybody is saying his recipe is the best recipe. Chinese lunar calendar, this is we know it. And if you can see in January, if you have sex on the 20th of January, you are about to have a girl. While if you have it on the 21st, you're going to have a boy. Biological rhythm. It's again an internet tool. You just put some data and then you get your rhythm, and this rhythm will tell you when you are going to have a boy or when you are going to have a girl. Some scientific methods to have sons that's equally present. Recipes use the fact that androgenic sperms, Y-carrying sperms are lighter, smaller, swim faster. So it was hypothesized that if the couple is having intercourse close to the time of ovulation, your chances of having a boy is higher than that if you have it a few days earlier on. Several days before, of course, X chromosomes, they thought it's stronger. We know all that women are stronger. So if you get back and have sex 3-4 days before the time of ovulation, which I don't know why, because we think that 24 hours and the sperms, the capability of sperms are much lower. Food. Woman wants a son, should have foods higher in sodium and potassium. If she wants to have a girl, have food rich in calcium and magnesium. And if you look it, you'll find 10,000 type of food that's available on the net that will tell you eat plah and don't eat the other thing. Now, why sex selection? The husband wants a son to carry his name. Obviously, in Muslim communities, inheritance issue is very, very strong. And balancing of the family. Economics. Male are simply a better investment in lower social classes and more valued by the society. And then you come to whatever the higher social classes we want, small, happy family, a mother, a boy, and the girl, and that's how it's marketed on the media. Whenever you are speaking about a happy family, you find a man, a woman, a boy, and a girl. Now we have to think, is it really sex selection or is it a male selection? when about 6,000 married women were questioned about their sex preference of their offspring. For all women who intended to have children in the future, the calculated sex preference ratio in favor of male was 1:4 to 100. And this ratio rises to about 190 if they are having infertility. So actually, we are speaking about huge imbalance. So if we would allow this, we'd have in Egypt, wasn't done in Gambia, it was done in sperm sorting, BGD, post-implantation, abortion, post-birth or postpartum methods, infanticide, child abandonment, and adoption. Sperm separation started in 1970, relies on a difference in Y chromosome, allowing Y chromosome to swim faster, and then use gradient, album gradient, percol, Cifadex, and you enrich the top layer, and then you take these and do artificial insemination by them. Laser beam is sorting Y and X chromosome, and then you get a higher proportion of X carrying, of Y carrying chromosomes, and it's very costly. At the time, it was $5,000 to have this sperm sorting. The process was only accurate 93% for producing girls and only 73% for producing boys. That's why actually it was never popular. I would imagine if the incidence was the reverse, it would have been different. Of the embryo, 48 cells and then fish and transfer only white carrying embryo. We're not speaking about CGS because this is actually another spectrum whatsoever, but this is the cheapest and the easiest for PGD. Amniocentesis. An Indian survey found that 96% of all aborted female fetuses were done after amniocentesis, which revealed the sex of the child. The use of this technology for sex selection might be accelerated with the introduction of sexual pre-selection technique, especially the price of amniocentesis getting down. Unless there is a fear.
Wait for another 2,300 years for Steptoe and Edwards to introduce us to this world of assisted reproduction. And today, of course, we have more than 5 million babies born to the technique of assisted reproduction. But from the beginning, there was always this dilemma, should we put too many embryos and risk the risk of having multiple pregnancies, or should we put too few and then having to face failure? How do we strike the balance right and have one single beautiful baby? Now, there are the answer, of course, is embryo selection. This can be done by invasive methods and non-invasive methods. And my contribution today is about non-invasive methods. But let me say something about the invasive methods, just one slide, because they are expensive, they require advanced skills, and they're not foolproof because of the possibility of embryo injury, of course, undetected mosaicism and segmental aneuploidy. And we are still in a dilemma between the two meta-analyses, the one which was produced by Mast and Broek, showing that, in fact, when you do this, you injure the embryo, then you have a lower live birth rate, as Professor Yaqub will tell you. And the other meta-analysis, which was produced more recently by Dahdouh from McGill University, where they said that there's no difference when you injure your embryo, but this was only about clinical implantation rate, not even clinical pregnancy rate or live birth rates. So let us stick to the non-invasive methods then, which can be done on the basis of morphology, morphokinetics, oxygen consumption by the individual embryos, or on the basis of measuring some biochemical markers in the culture medium, or the oxidative stress to which individual embryos are subjected, and finally combination of markers. But let me say something before starting, that in this, in order to come with a method of embryo selection, it is a three steps exercise, really. You really want to make sure that there is a difference between those who become pregnant and those who do not become pregnant using your method. Then, or actually, better even, for those who will achieve a live birth versus those which not achieve a live birth. Then if you do the opinion of Dr. Yacoub again,
there's nothing to be gained by extending the culture of a limited number of embryos. They are better in than out.
Yeah.
For simple common sense reasons. You don't have problems with the incubator, right? Selection wise, and the uterus will provide the right environment, probably better than outside.
Yeah.
So, consequently, embryos to let them grow up to their five.
Yeah, I don't know if somebody has studied this, but I would go for five embryos. And again, I would like to.
It depends on your target. If you have decided to put a single embryo, if you have two embryos in your culture, to day five. But if you are adjusting to the individual circumstances of patient and you are open-minded about two or one, then if you have two, put it back. If you have three, you can give the benefit of the doubt and extend to day five.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Last question.
More question? Yeah.
Okay. Let's vote for the question on the board.
All right. These are the questions. Yeah. The cleaver stage. All the following are criteria of a good embryo, except. Should be an easy one. At least for those who are working in assisted production.
Okay, thank you very much.
Substrate. Has been shown. I guess. Type, okay, Bart. Yeah, it's none of the above. Yeah. Next question then, the final one. Prospective randomized studies about to have shown that the following is the best method of embryo selection and reproduction. Evaluation of the embryo morphokinetics. But assisted pattern recognition, measure oxidative stress, well, none of the above.
In 15 minutes.